Perhaps the most passionate views of all are those of the Druids. English Heritage's plans to exhibit bones and cremated remains from the site in the new visitor centre have come up against some fierce opposition.
This ground is hallowed to us. Taking away the ancestors is bad enough. Putting them on display in bloody cabinets to make money at their visitor centre is not going to happen. Because when they open that new visitor centre, biggest capital project English Heretics have done, 20 years in the planning.
Who knew that? I mean, all this stuff about English Heretics, this is all news to me. I wasn't even really aware of this whole issue.
Because we believe that those who are laid to rest should stay to rest.
But he really feels it very strongly. I mean, it's quite tempting when you turn up, see all these guys wearing what they're wearing and sort of dismiss them as being these crackpots. There is obviously something eccentric about this group of people, but he really passionately believes in what he's talking about. It's a matter of belief, and belief's an important thing that we should respect, even if he's carrying a shield with a dragon on it.
I intend to take non-violent direct action against them and any means of my disposal.
This issue with the bones seems to be where the beliefs of the Druids come up against the business of the heritage industry. The landscape surrounding Stonehenge is where some of the remains were found. Pat Shelley, Henge enthusiast and tour guide, is showing me around.
So we're heading towards a burial mound, is it?
Yeah, a burial mound. There's hundreds and hundreds in this landscape. Have a look over to your right there. Can you see some on the ridge in amongst the trees?
Yeah, loads.
Loads there. There's more in the trees to the left. Most of them, not all, but most of them have been dug. What they were after were the grave goods.
The gold.
The gold, in some cases, yeah. In all the digging that's taken place in and around Stonehenge, what you don't have is any evidence of day-to-day life. No houses, hearths, quern stones for grinding grain. It's as if Stonehenge was built in isolation of people. And what we do have around here are hundreds and hundreds of these barrows, these burial mounds. And at Stonehenge itself, 150 plus sets of cremated remains. So we're talking about a huge necropolis, the largest Neolithic Bronze Age cemetery in the country, right, by far.
I mean, is there any sort of pattern to the way they're arranged here?
They're all on little ridges, and they all have this kind of sight line over to Stonehenge itself. The barrows are integral to Stonehenge and Stonehenge to the barrows. And people that come on a tour or bother to come out into the landscape, what you have to remember is that for most people who have their ancestry in Western Europe, they will be genetically linked to the people that built Stonehenge.
The visitor centre is only a few months from being finished, and the exhibition will be key to the success of the redevelopment. But for Arthur Pendragon, the bones are more than just archaeological finds.
That was a very rousing speech I heard you deliver earlier. How do you feel it went?
I think it went well, and I think we're going to have quite a few people here to basically rain on English Heretics Parade when they decide to open this brand new visitor centre. I mean, for the past 14 years, I've supported them, and I'm still supporting the idea of the visitor centre, but putting ancient cremated human remains and bones from these burial mounds from the environs of Stonehenge on display as some sort of Victorian peep show. It's just not happening.
Why do you feel so strongly about it?
Because they're the ancestors. And to my mind, it doesn't matter whether you died 3 months ago or 3,000 years ago. Dead is still dead. I mean, one of the archaeologists said to me, "You don't know they want to be buried here." And I said, "No, and you don't know. Your gran wants to be in that churchyard, but we're not digging her up." How would they feel?
It's interesting you use this analogy of a grandparent. Do you feel a sense of personal connection in some way with the people who are buried here?
Yes, they were the founding fathers of our nation. And to end up in a display case in a visitor centre, it's not very respectful, is it?
Well, it's very well-established museum practice to show human remains. It's always something that's done with reverence and respect, and we believe it's a perfectly legitimate thing to do. Of course, we respect the views of the Grand Order of Druids, led by Arthur Pendragon. I mean, we respect his views, and he's entitled to feel uncomfortable about it. But he does not represent a very large proportion of society. The vast majority of people feel quite comfortable with the dignified display of human remains.
Would it make your life easier if this minority of people, the Druids, if they didn't really have such a vested interest in the stones?
It would make all of our lives less colourful.
That's a very political answer.
It isn't, it's just true.
As dawn throws into shadowy relief the giant pillars of Stonehenge, the successors of the ancient Druids await the first rays of midsummer sun.
The Druids are such an essential part of our perception of Stonehenge, but the fact that they're there at all is down to one man. In 1740, the antiquarian William Stukeley published a book that would revolutionise our understanding of Stonehenge.
This is very special. This is a first edition of William Stukeley's Stonehenge. What I love about the title page is that it almost seems to enact, if you like, the tension that's at the heart of this book, because you have the very rational script which says Stonehenge, a temple restored, and then the words British Druids are in this gothic, much more seemingly irrational font.
This book is Stukeley's masterpiece, and it took him more than 20 years to write.
This is a work of rational analysis. It's trying to classify and codify the stones, which is something that hadn't properly been done, even though they'd been standing for thousands of years. It strikes us now as so simple as an idea that you might actually work out specifically the distances, the dimensions of Stonehenge to help understand what it was used for, its significance. But Stukeley was the first one to do that.
But it's here that Stukeley departs from his meticulous measurements and wanders into the fertile world of his imagination.
Now here he's getting into the Druids. They carried a sharp brass instrument, which we often find, which they used to cut mistletoe at their great festival in midwinter. The manner of sacrificing. There's clearly real profound engagement on Stukeley's part with this kind of almost romantic history of the Druids. It's quite a dark sense of what they used this temple of Stonehenge for. And it's a curious thing, this, because in a sense, his fascination with Druids was just a piece of fantasy. And as a result, for subsequent generations of scholars, it did slightly undermine the overall achievement of this book.
William Stukeley died in 1765, a figure of ridicule among his fellow antiquarians. But his ideas about the Druids lived on.
Good morning.
Actually, I'm not a practice in Druids, and as I've missed the summer solstice, I'm not likely to bump into any. Which is probably a good job, because I don't think they'd take kindly to a stranger in their midst. They might even have decided to have sacrificed me. And I am too young to die.
How do you feel about archaeologists who sort of, well, they dismiss the idea that Druids built Stonehenge?
To us, they were proto-Druids. Whoever built that, built it as a solar clock to map out the time of year. The longest, the shortest, and the equal days. They didn't call themselves Druids because nobody was Druids then. But they were proto-Druids. They were still following the same belief structure that modern Druids to this day. You've just seen us in there celebrating the equal day. Well, it was obviously part of the belief structure of the people that built Stonehenge. So it doesn't matter whether they were Druids. It doesn't matter if they were Irish navvies who built it. Whoever built it to honour the longest and the shortest day. Whoever buried the people in and around here and in these burial mounds that encircle it, buried them in what was and is, to us, a sacred landscape.
The building of Stonehenge was just the beginning. And our cities are now full of modern megaliths.
We're looking out here across London. What do you think archaeologists of the future would make of this scene?
Well, I think they'll get it all wrong, as usual. But I think if you believe that what a culture puts its greatest energies into is what means most to it, then I'm afraid I think that it will be a landscape that reveals an extraordinary obsession with money.
Stukeley was obsessed with uncovering what Stonehenge meant to the people who built it, but he had very little to go on.
Do you think it's unfair that some people seem to write Stukeley off as a bit of a nutter?
Yes, I do. He was the first person to realise that the thing was oriented in some way with the solstice. Now, once you do that, you're no longer in the business of just measuring things and digging things. You're now involved with something that has purpose and motive and meaning. So you have to begin to try and work out what that might be. Of course, as he went on, he filled in more and more of the details, and I think people were less and less persuaded. On the other hand, if one looks at Stukeley's legacy, people still use his measurements. He measured features at Stonehenge that have since disappeared, so the archaeologists are indebted to him. But his legacy to our present experience of Stonehenge is also huge. Stukeley said there were druids at Stonehenge. OK, when he said it, there weren't. There are now.
There is a third prong to Stukeley's legacy at Stonehenge, one that's possibly the most influential of all.
It was one of Stukeley's many interventions in the history of Stonehenge that he did turn it into a tourist site. He was the first person to make other people want to go there just to see it, though I think he would have been astonished and dismayed by what's happened since in terms of its exploitation as a tourist site, when it was just referred to always as a toilet stop on the Bath to London Road. I think it says a lot about us that we could have reduced such an extraordinary monument to that.
Back on site, the road is being dug up and the fences are finally coming down. The old facilities are being consigned to history. The landscape is starting to regain some of its old magic. A magic that's inspired some of our greatest minds. By the early 19th century, the Romantics had embraced the stones, adding their own layer of mystery and intrigue. The poet William Blake depicts Stonehenge as a terrifying scene of human sacrifice. A building of eternal death, whose proportions are eternal despair. Here Valor stood, turning the iron spindle of destruction from heaven to earth. Eleven miles away in Salisbury, hangs one of the most famous images of Stonehenge from the Romantic period, or from any period, really.
This is the watercolour of Stonehenge that Turner created in the 1820s, and it's become probably the best-known visual artwork of Stonehenge. Don't be fooled by the brightness of it, which seems initially to be quite picturesque and alluring, because actually, Turner saw in Stonehenge something quite menacing, sinister. It was a place of foreboding. In the foreground, you have a shepherd with his flock, but this shepherd has been killed. He's been struck by a bolt of lightning. The storm's passing, you can see another bolt of lightning in the background. And next to him, his faithful dog is howling because his master won't respond. Some of the sheep have been struck down as well, but now they're milling. There's a sense of